hasn't even shipped yet.
Hey, everybody. Just real second. We're getting several texts from folks saying that they're calling traffic, so we're going to wait about 10 minutes if everybody, well, whether or not you're okay with it, I guess we're going to wait about 10 minutes. But we told everybody out in the hall, and there are quite, if it was just a few people, but there are quite a few people that were trying to get here that are saying that they're trying to get off the interstate right now, 75's backed up. So we're going to try to give them about 10 minutes, but we won't go any longer than that. Okay? Thank you.
Sheriff. And, well, I had the two phones, but I didn't have the gun.
And they said, well, you keep giving grief to local elected officials, and we thought you were one of us because you were a local elected official. And the answer is follow the law. It's not, you used to be a local elected official, so now leave them alone. You don't leave anyone alone, you follow the law. You don't pick the winners and losers. And then I literally, as a result of that, totally changed my talk, which is, this is all about how you demonstrate maturity. The voters approved your selection. It doesn't mean you know the answers to any questions. It means you fooled them. You won. Now you have to show maturity and be worthy of their vote. So I told them all type things like, you know, the whole adage, the old adage, what would your mother say? And before you take a vote, before you do something, think about it. It's all about leaving with the same integrity that you came into office with. So I've enjoyed working with the college here, the Humanities College, the School of Communications. I think it's really important, the programs. The funniest thing I had, I think, with this school when I was AG is they had one of their students that annual process to see whether folks actually will respond in time pursuant to Georgia law. And one of the students called up my office and said, I can't believe you bill in 6-minute increments, you know, a tenth of an hour. And the answer was, yes, we're lawyers. You bill tenths of the hour. So I think it's really important. We did pass the rewrite. I spent a lot of time with Sean, who will be here shortly, a lot of time with Holly. At first they thought I was crazy. At first the legislature thought I was crazy, because the fear of changing the sunshine laws is that the legislature will weaken them rather than strengthen them. And at the very end of the process, which took me 2 years, we were in a meeting with Tom Clyde, who's at least one of the lawyers, if not the main lawyer for the HAC, and we were at a hearing of the House Judiciary Committee, and Sean was there too, and he wanted, I think, 4 or 5 changes to make them happy with the bill. And the chair of that committee, Wendell Willard, gave him either 3 out of 4 or 4 out of 5, and he left that hearing giddy. What happened? He actually succeeded. They did what was desired. And then in the Senate, thankfully, no amendments. It just cleared the Senate. Actually, no votes in the Senate. 1 no vote in the House. And a lot of it was literally to make it more user-friendly. It really is 3 days. And if you can't do it in 3 days, you need to say within 3 days when you can do it. Make it easier to get stuff over the internet. You don't have to use paper nowadays. That you can have someone designated for an agenda item to receive all the requests, to make it user-friendly. But I'll tell you the same thing that I told Sean, that I told numerous folks. No one believed me, but it's the truth. The press pays 90% of attention to documents. They pay 10% attention to meetings. There is that other thing called the Open Meetings Act. When you attend a meeting and it's over in 20 minutes, but the book's this thick, you missed the right meeting. So for instance, in Cobb, Lisa, you'll tell me if it's still the same now, Monday morning before the Tuesday meeting, there's a work session where they go over each section of the agenda. And if any commissioners have questions, they ask the staff. That's the real meeting. That's what commissioners will say, I really don't like the way this is worded, it needs to be revised. And then between then and Tuesday, they'll work on an amendment for the meeting. Seldom did any members of the press go to that Monday morning work session. Do they come now?
One was there today.
Okay, so that's the real meeting, because that's when the work's done, last minute questions with the elected officials. I don't know if Fayette does it the same way or not. I know when I was chair of Cobb, I once showed up to a Smyrna City Council meeting, and beforehand they had me go to the work session. There was never press. So it was the Wild West, because the press is there to be that safeguard at that point. So I would just simply restate Justice Meltner's famous quote in Georgia law, which is the public official's quote must conduct the public's business out in the open. And that's really, really important. I mean, we have a lot of talk nowadays about the press. And that's a healthy discussion. I don't view that as a negative. That's a healthy discussion. But at the end of the day, if the press isn't public, if the press isn't active, then we really don't have a good democracy. And we really don't have a vibrant system of government. So it was always my pleasure. Now this guy, every time I'd go to Valdosta, I'd meet with him. And he would always tell me things that my office needed to do better. But that's once again positive. Because the only way you can improve is through that discussion. So having members of the press say, you need to do this, you need to do that, I always view that as a positive. You can always improve. No one is perfect. No one's close to perfect. Just ask my wife. So I used to really enjoy those meetings with Jim back then. And it's important. You didn't know that I knew that about the old hospital system as much
as you know a lot more.
They had a lot of shenanigans going on in their hospital system down there, which is a shame. And I knew about it, but the law didn't frankly help me in several of those areas. So it's a pleasure to be here. I look forward to everyone enjoying tonight. I said nice things about you, Sean. I talked about that House Judiciary meeting with Tom Clyde and you to get those last changes in 397.
Yes.
The codes. I mean, I spent a lot of time. Last thing I'll say. So we're done. We passed the bill. Everyone's happy. It counts. And I go up to Sean and I said, I've spent a lot of time with you, right? And she said, yes. And I said, so I have a favor to ask of you. And she got pretty white. And I said, I want a print of Mike Lukovich's drawing on 9/12, the day after 9/11, where you look in the Statue of Liberty's eyes and you see the Twin Towers and you see the tears. I thought Lukovich was brilliant. That was an amazing depiction. And she said, that's what you want. I said, I'm never going to sell it. I'm not looking. It's in my office. You go to my office, it's right there. But they still didn't trust me. So it says, to Sam, from Mike Lukovich. But I was never going to sell it. I just thought, you know, some political...
It's worth a lot more when it's signed, even if you didn't.
Well, the point of the matter is, you know, you look at them every day, and these folks are brilliant to do that work. But some days you sit there and say, oh my God, they just superseded any expectations, which I thought Mike did that day after 9/11. We actually had a commission meeting 9/11. I know where I was that day. So it's my pleasure. I look forward to y'all having a great program. I was at Nydia's infamous arrest. As Nydia would tell you, I was the only elected official who actually defended her. Because you don't arrest the press for videoing a group gathering.
And thank you.
That's just a fact. You don't do it. That wasn't appropriate. And I'm sure I'm going to see this as it gets closer to her trial. Thank you very, very much. Thank you.
Okay, this Lauren Leathers is the president of the campus SPJ chapter. Mr. Lauren.
Yes, thank you so much, Sam. So Jim Zachary and Ken Foskett are both members of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation that we're speaking today. Jim Zachary is also the director of Transparency Project of Georgia and chairman of the Ed Publishing Company, which serves UGA. He's a four-time winner of the Georgia Press Association's Freedom of Information Award and three-time winner of the Associated Press Media Editor Freedom of Information Award. Ken Foskett has been an AJC reporter and editor since 1989. Currently, he is a senior editor of Investigations, where he leads a team of experienced investigative journalists to report stories that have local and national impact. In 2015, he won the Investigative Reporters and Editors Award for Innovation in Investigative Reporting. Thank you all for being here today.
Okay, so we're going to jump right in. I don't know if y'all know or not, but this past weekend was the 40th anniversary of Smokey and the Bandit being filmed down in Jonesboro, Georgia. and the spirit of Smokey and the Bandit, we got a long way to go and a short time to get there. So we're going to speed things up as much as possible. We want to talk in the beginning about why we do this, why we talk about this, why these issues are important. Then we're going to talk about open meetings. And I agree with what Ken said, that we spend a lot of time talking about public records and not nearly enough time talking about the importance of open meetings. And as a journalist, one of the things that I see the most are violations of the Georgia Open Meetings Act that I believe happen all the time in every part of Georgia. And we'll talk about that. Ken's going to talk a lot to us about public records and how to leverage those and what the law says. I also agree with Ms. Rowlands about it's simply a matter of doing what the law says. But larger than that, the bigger picture is it's a dirty, rotten shame that we need laws to tell elected and appointed officials to keep the public's business public.
Sure.
We shouldn't have to have laws to tell people to do the right thing and to do the public's business out in the open. Okay, so we need to do this quick little exercise before we get started. And honestly, nobody gets vilified for the way that you answer the question. But let me see a show of hands if you identify yourself as a journalist. So we've got a lot of journalists in the room, and that's great. Some citizen journalists, some folks that are actually getting paid for it, which is about the only difference that I can tell. And not much, I know. But we've got some folks from broadcast, we've got some folks from print media, we've got some folks from radio and television, so that's great. So if you identify yourself as simply a citizen that cares about good governance, let me see your hands. Excellent. It's so great to see you here and to know that you believe that we are the governed and the governed is us. We are self-governed people, and we're going to talk about that in the beginning as well. Now, if you are an elected, appointed official, work for government, don't raise your hand. Will you please stand up for us and let us see who you are? If you work in government, if you're elected, if you're appointed,
easier target that way.
So, will all of y'all join me in thanking them for being here? The relationship between records requesters and records custodians does not have to be adversarial. Sometimes we needlessly make it that way, both on the part of us requesters and sometimes on the part of those custodians. The relationship between commissioners and members of boards of education and city council persons does not have to be adversarial. Sometimes we make it that way. But we want to talk about how we can work better with government and how government can work better for us. So, Ken, you have any other opening words before we start?
You know, the only other thing I'd like to say is I do want to give a special shout out to our hosts here at KSU for having us here. The local chapter of SPJ is someone who works with a lot of young journalists, and very happy to see young people here in the room. And also, I want to give a special shout out to Commissioner Lisa Cupid, who was really the genesis of us coming up here in Cobb County. Lisa, as you know, is on our board of directors, and the reason she's on that board is because 2 years ago, or 3 years ago, I guess it is now, when Cobb County was going to vote on the stadium deal for the new Braves Stadium, Lisa Cupid was the only person that was willing to get out in front of that train. And the reason she did that was largely because the process was very fast, and there was not enough transparency for the voters and the public to really understand this deal, what it meant, how much it was going to cost, and so forth. So she is a strong, strong advocate for the reason that we are here tonight, which is to make government, transparency and to hold people accountable for keeping things open. So Lisa, thank you very much for getting
about transparency. We're talking about tearing down those walls that exist between the people and their business. It is part and parcel of who and what we are. It is about democracy. It is about freedom. These things that we're going to talk about today are not partisan in any way. Open government is neither Republican or Democrat. Open government is neither to the right or to the left. I think that sometimes you will find that the particular party that is out of power is the one that is the most open, and the one that's in power is the one that's the most closed. But none of the things that we're going to talk about fit any party platform. It's simply about good governance. And it's who and what we are. It's the way that we were founded as a nation. We're going to take some things that you well know, and it's going to sound like eighth grade civics class for a moment or two. The Declaration of Independence declares that government only has the power that we give it. So if you're not happy with government, in part at least, you're to blame for that. We're the ones that put people on county commission. We're the ones that put people on city council. We're the ones that elect members of boards of education. And guess what? We're the ones that can take them off. What do y'all suspect that voter turnout is in your respective voting precincts on a non-presidential election year? I bet you it's 20%. And that's pitiful. If we're going to be a self-governed people, we're going to have to participate in government at a higher level. The First Amendment courses through the veins of a lot of people that are in this room. I know that it's driven Ken's career. I would like to think that it had defined mine in many ways. It's really kind of why we started doing this, wasn't it? You know, if neither one of us can remember back that far, but it's kind of what drove us here. And in those precious 45 words, the fathers guaranteed us, we like to say they guaranteed us five freedoms, I think they guaranteed us six. And in those six freedoms, it defines the relationship that we have with our government. So that you know that, my finger works way too fast. So let me do this real quick. So you know what those freedoms are. That we are guaranteed by the First Amendment the freedom of religion, the freedom of speech, the freedom of the press, the right to peaceably assemble, the right to petition government for a redress of our grievances. If, in fact, the press is free to report on what government is and what government does, if, in fact, the press is free to hold government accountable, then it stands to reason that the press has access to what government is doing and not doing. If, in fact, all of us, not just the press, all of us have the freedom of speech, and ostensibly the fathers were talking about speech that was critical of government, right? They weren't just talking about your ability to get up in a crowded theater and scream fire, right? They were talking about the right of the citizenry to criticize government, to hold government accountable. Well, it stands to reason that the public has a right to know about what pieces of paper are being held in government halls and to know what government is doing even when they slide in the back door after having been in the backyard or in the back room. And so that's why we believe that the First Amendment guarantees us more than five, but six freedoms, the sixth implied freedom of transparency or open government. Ken, you have anything to add about that?
Very well said.
So I want to just very quickly tell you that this is not anything new, right? It's not just that in 2017, a couple of newspaper guys with some First Amendment lawyers all of a sudden decided that government needed to be open. It really defines us as a nation, and really it sets us apart from the rest of the world, or at least it ought to. One of my favorite quotes is when Thomas Jefferson called information the currency of democracy. That our very freedom can only be exercised when we have free and open access to information. Knowing not just what government does, but knowing why government does it. We have a right to not only know what decisions government is reaching, but how they derive at those decisions, to hear the deliberative process. Thomas Jefferson also said that whenever the people are well informed, they can be trusted with their government. And I don't know that anybody could have said it better than JFK did when you said the very word secrecy is repugnant in a free society. So you can do all your own Google searches, but please understand that the founders believed in the importance of access to government. And the only way that democracy works is when we exercise our rights to be a self-governed people and take government into our own hands. The press has traditionally been regarded as the fourth estate, holding government accountable. But all the things that we're going to talk about today, whether you're talking about the value and importance of newspapers or other media represented here today, all the laws that Ken is going to talk about are not media laws. These are not press laws. Open government exists for everyone. You don't have to have that fancy-dancy little press badge from the Georgia Press Association to access public records or to be able to attend all open public meetings. So I began by saying it's just really unfortunate that transparency laws are even needed. And we should believe that what government does is our business. That's why the open meetings are critical. So we'll talk to you about what the law says, but then we want you to be thinking about this as we go through it and thinking about what questions that you might have, or even anecdotally, what experiences that you might have had with respect to attending meetings or with what elected officials like to call executive session. And our mutual friend, who unfortunately isn't with us tonight, Holly Mannheimer, is one of the fiercest open government advocates that I have known in my lifetime. And Holly used to always refuse to say, when we did these things together, she used to refuse to let the words executive session come out of her mouth. She said, "Jim, we need to stop calling it executive session and call it what it is." And I said, "What's that, Holly?" And she said, "A closed door meeting." And so she would only call them closed door meetings. Well, the open meetings law applies to any government agency or body. So it's not just what you might think of with respect to, say, your county commission, but all committees of the county commission. Not just the Board of Education, but all the committees that the Board of Education may have. For instance, its Finance Committee. How many of you journalists ever attend the meetings of the Finance Committee? Yeah, for those of you non-journalists, do you know why journalists don't go to Finance Committee meetings? They write because they don't do math. But also, Kent, nonprofit agencies may be susceptible to the Open Meetings Act as well.
That's right, because they get those that get government funding. Right. Yeah.
So kind of the litmus test, not just in Georgia, but in most states, is if you get a third of your pie comes from government sources, then you're subject to the same open meetings and open records legislation as any government body. In addition to that, a case that maybe I can get Ken to talk about just a little bit later with respect to records, if government bequeaths its powers or turns over its work to a non-government agency, like, oh, I don't know, but let's make one up, Northside Hospital, they also should be held to the same standards. And hopefully the Georgia Supreme Court is going to rule correctly on that thing. Here's something that, where'd Sam go? Dadgum, where's he at when I need him? So I was asked, actually this morning when I was doing a taping, I was asked a question about how I would grade Georgia's open government legislation. My answer, to be candid, was B minus, C plus. It's about as good as it's going to get with me. And one of the great weaknesses in open meetings, is that too generous?
Yes.
I was trying to be a nice guy. So one of the great weaknesses in our open meetings legislation in Georgia, and I'll solicit y'all's help if we can ever get the General Assembly to open this thing up again. We need to get the quorum language out of the Open Meetings Act. So here's what the law says, that no quorum of any elected body can meet in private to discuss the public's business. Here's the problem with that. It allows vote getting. As a matter of fact, there's even a name for it in Georgia. Y'all know about this? There's a name for it in Georgia. Elected officials don't like to tell you, but if you ever hear two members of a Board of Education say, let's play 3-on-3, you know what that is? If a quorum is made up of 4 or 5, this 3 will get together and talk, and that 3 will get together and talk, and they'll vote get among one another, and they will get around the Georgia Open Meetings Act because of the quorum language. Y'all know what they say down in Florida? You know what they say up in Tennessee? Our neighbors to the north and neighbors to the south? Here's what their open meetings legislation says. That no 2 or more elected officials of the same body can deliberate the public's business in private. That's better law. So that no 2 or more in other states, Georgia says no more. Yes?
I just want to see how you want to play this. Are you taking questions as you talk, or do you want us to wait?
You interrupt and we'll give it a shot. How's that?
Okay. Thank you so much. But did I hear you correctly when you made a statement? I think I heard that bodies that receive public monies are subject to open meetings law.
Not just if they receive public monies. If a third of their total budget comes from public funded sources, so if a third of their budget is government money, then they're subject.
That's right.
Okay. So there is a.
There's a threshold.
There's a threshold. So it's a third of the dollars. Less than a third, yeah, they still can do.
Right. Okay. So guess what some of them do?
There's no cap on that third. Say if you have a third up to like $2 million or $5 million, then you still got to be open because you're getting so much.
Just a third. That's so what some of them do is always make sure that it's 32.9%.
Right.
So you can't pursue those sometimes through contractual.
Right.
So if you've hired a firm that you work for the county government or the city government, you can do an open record request with the company.
Right.
What they have.
Right, and we talk about that from a records point of view when we start talking about records, but you're exactly right. Plus, let's say, for instance, that a government has contracted with a private contractor and they're sharing information on government email. It's all open public records.
They hide a lot of times, jurisdictions will hide documents in the contractor's files and say, we don't have anything in our files. We've looked in our files and the contractor has it, so I have to look at.
Okay, so sometimes the journalists get a little bit too aggressive, and they find out that a whole car full of county commissioners got in the van, and they traveled to Athens or to Savannah or to Atlanta or someplace for a meeting, and they say, oh, I got you. Y'all met. Well, the state says you can do that. Or maybe they all showed up together for a big groundbreaking ceremony for an $85 million. We just built an $85 million high school in Valdosta, y'all. Wow. But it is the home of the Wildcats. But they can do that. State says they can do that. They can meet ceremonially. They can meet casually. They can run into one another in a restaurant. But when they're doing that, if there is a quorum of them, they cannot do business. So the best you can do is eavesdrop. And I'm telling you, eavesdrop. Listen, I had a reporter call me the other day. Actually, it's been a few weeks ago, but I call everything the other day. I had a reporter call me the other day and say, Jim, I don't know where I stand on this thing because the Board of Education had one of those executive sessions and they forgot that the walls were thin and I heard everything they said. Can I use it? And I said, I'd be embarrassed if you didn't. Right? There's no law against hearing what can be heard in a public space. And so their closed door session had a door closed but an open window. And he heard everything they said. Man, it was a doozy. So there are certain things that are excluded, like inspections of facilities. They can go to seminars, training. They can even show up to me to hear me and Ken talk, or mostly me. Ken's going to talk more in a little bit. But here's the most important thing that I can teach you about open meetings tonight. That here's what the law says. That everything is open unless there's an exception. So the presumption in Georgia law is that it's always open. You're going to hear the same thing about records here in a little bit. So that openness is the law. As a matter of fact, did you know that I think Sam wrote these words. I like to give him credit for it anyway. That the strong public policy of the state of Georgia is open government. So that there has to be an exception that allows them to go back there behind closed doors. There has to be an exception that allows them to have those executive sessions. There has to be an exception, and they have to be able to cite the legal exception. You don't listen to me. You don't have to prove that something should be open. They have to prove that it can be closed. That's a writable down, right? You don't have to prove that it should be open. They have to prove that it can be closed. That's the way the law is written. As a matter of fact, it's the way that both open meetings and open records legislation.
Same is true for records, too. Absolutely the same principle.
What is the punishment if they can't? The meeting's over.
Okay, so Georgia is one of the few states in the United States that actually imposes a real penalty for violations of the Act. In most states, the penalty for violating the Act is exactly like this. In Georgia, first violation can cost you $1,000. A second violation in the same 12-month period can cost you $2,500, as can subsequent violations, and they can be concurrent. Now, I'm going to be transparent and say not too many governments have ever paid that in Georgia. It has been imposed a few times. I've been involved in a few cases where penalties have been levied. But please know that that is one of the best things about Georgia's open meetings and open records legislation, is that it has teeth. Now we just got to get it enforced.
And you have to file suit to get that $2,500?
No. The Attorney General can pursue it. Now, this is me editorializing 100%. I personally believe that districts of attorneys ought to be able to prosecute the Open Meetings and Open Records Act. But it's never going to happen. Don't hold your breath. But it can be prosecuted through the AG's office. Let me give you a name. You got your pencil sharp? Write this name down. Jennifer Colangelo. You're on your own when it comes to spelling.
I've got it spelled.
Jennifer Colangelo is a bright young attorney in the Attorney General's office who is tasked, whose job is to keep meetings open and to keep public records public. She can be your best friend. Let me give you a warning. If you're going to write Jennifer Colangelo and make a complaint about an open meetings or an open records violation, let me give you a strong recommendation. Do your homework. Know your case before you ever make your case. Don't waste their time. Because if you cry wolf too many times, you're not going to be heard. Okay, so let's drill down meetings a little bit more. I get a lot of questions about public notice. The law says I have to give 1 week prior notice, and it's got to be placed in a conspicuous place. What in the heck does that mean? I don't know. Some of them will put it on a door, some of them will put it on a bulletin board, some of them will put it on a wall. Most of them will put it on their websites. If there's a special call meeting, the legal organ in the county is to be given 24 hours notice in advance. The legal organ's not under any legal obligation to run it, but they have to be notified of it. special circumstance meetings are a little bit different, and you're not going to like this, I'm sure, because what the law says is that they should give as much notice as is reasonable. Who decides what's reasonable? So, yeah, you know, but please understand, that doesn't necessarily mean that something is nefarious, right? So let's say, for instance, that they only keep a $1,500 fund balance in discretionary spending at City Hall, and the roof caves in because of a heavy rain, and it's going to cost them $2,500 to get a contractor there. They might need to have a special circumstance meeting. So it doesn't mean necessarily that something is nefarious if, in fact, they have one of those meetings. Agenda is supposed to be available upon request. It's supposed to be on the table or posted somewhere at the meeting site. Now, how many lawyers are in the room? Listen, I respect lawyers a lot. Please don't take offense to this. You can always tell a lawyer, but you just can't tell them much. You know this was written by a group of lawyers, because here's what the law says about agendas. They should be posted sometime during a 2 week prior to the meeting. What in the world does that mean? Is 14 days within a 2 week period? Is 13 days within a 2 week period? Is 24 hours within a 2 week period? I don't know why they just did this.
Is it business days or is it calendar?
Yeah, is it calendar days? Is it work days? What about a holiday?
Written by lawyers.
All right, sorry. People get really confused over these two things, so that minutes may not be available and should not be available until immediately, I don't know what this means either, but immediately after the next meeting following the meeting where the minutes were taken. So let's say they meet the second Monday of every month, right? So then the second Monday in June, they have a meeting and the secretary takes the minutes. So then the second Monday in July when they have a meeting, they've got to have those minutes approved at the meeting and then made immediately available if you request them. So I guess that means that, you know, that they've got to run somewhere in copy form if you request them right then. Most of the government agencies that we cover will go ahead and have some, and they'll have them in a folder and they'll get them out to you if you ask for them. But 2 days after the meeting, and I guarantee you most of your county commissions don't do this, nor do they know they have to. 2 days after the meeting, they're supposed to have a meeting summary available. Anybody thinks that their city council or county commissioner boards of education always does that? Because most don't, and most don't know that they have to. Now, that summary is a summary. It doesn't have to give you the details of what happened in the meeting, but it has to tell you what action, what formal action was ratified at the meeting. Yes, ma'am.
Is there any specific as to where these need to be made available? Would you have to call,
Kim talked about this with respect to records. Some of this kind of blends records and meetings, because, you know, minutes and agendas are part and parcel of meetings, but they're also contained in the Records Act. But every county and city, every jurisdiction is required to designate a records custodian and to make that records custodian available to the public and known to the public. So you ought to be able to call your county or your board of education or get on their website and find out who the designated records custodian is. And the state doesn't say what office they need to hold. Doesn't say it's got to be the county clerk. It could just, some counties actually have a records custodian and that's their only job. Cool gig if you can get it. But they have to make that person available, and that's the person that's got to know where to get the document out. Here's a doozy for you. So when they rewrote the act in 2012, it was ratified in April of 2012, it was a vast improvement over what Georgia previously had. But just like Smokey and the Bandit, it still has a long way to go and a short time to get there. So executive sessions, closed door meetings, are required to have minutes, whether they're hand recorded or tape recorded. Minutes must be recorded, but those minutes are not public record. So how do you get them? You sue them for a meetings violation. And then they may be made available to discovery. So they have to keep them, but you can't get them. So what are the specific exceptions? There are largely three exceptions. There are a few more exceptions codified throughout the law, but there are largely three. We usually sort of broad stroke that by saying it's personnel, litigation, and real estate. It's important that you know that the law is much more specific than those three things, so that not all, and this is important, this is one of those write-em-down things, not all personnel can be talked about in the executive session. Not all things that are called litigation can be talked about in the executive session. And not all real estate can be talked about in the executive session. I like it when I simplify things. I don't know if y'all do or not. But a good friend of mine used to be the county chair down in Henry County, Tommy Smith. Good guy. Really good guy. And believes in open government, I think, to his core. He is since retired. Tommy used to say he would not go into executive session for real estate unless it had an address. And he would not go into executive session for personnel unless it had a first, middle, and a last name. And he wouldn't go into executive session for litigation unless it had at least one piece of paper. His thinking was, and I think he was exactly right, was that the law is very specific, and we should not cast a broad net. Elected officials should not put this big umbrella to conceal the public's business by saying, oh, we're going to go talk about personnel, when in fact they're talking public policy. Now, y'all may not think that happens. I guarantee you it happens. Let me tell you what it looks like. We've got executive session tonight for personnel. They go back in the back room. You know, we've got this star teacher at Hay Highland Middle School, and we're going to lose it. Everybody's recruiting. We've got to come up with some incentives to retain this star teacher. Y'all thought I was going to get down and dirty, didn't you? Tell some better teacher. We're going to go high. So we got this star teacher. We're going to lose her. We need to find a way to incentivize her. Let's bonus her. We can't give everybody a bonus, but let's bonus her and reward her for the great work that she's doing. Well, wait a minute, Jim. I agree with you. She's a star teacher, and we need to bonus her. But do you think that there's a way, without really digging into our budget, that we could show all of our teachers how much we appreciate them? Guess what? You just stopped talking about personnel and started talking about policy. You're deceiving yourselves if you think that discussion does not happen all the time. All the time in executive session. Another example. These are real examples, by the way, y'all. I don't make stuff. Well, maybe I do make stuff up. My sister's here. She knows I make stuff up. So, that's Brenda Lee back there. So, the reason I talk so much and talk so loud is our group of five sisters. There's Rosalie, Linda Lee, Brenda Lee, Sherry Lee, and Jimmy Lee. I was the only boy in the baby of the family. My sister Sherry Lee grew up and got married to a guy named Donnie Lee. So I named her Sherry Lee Lee. Sherry Lee Lee. She got divorced, so I named her Sherry Lee Etzel. So we've got this vacant piece of property over here adjacent to the high school. It's just sitting there. Y'all think we ought to sell it? That's real estate, right? Mm-hmm. Y'all think we ought to sell it? You know, we could sell it. But I was thinking, we ought to put a Lounge High School Viking sign right there. Draw people in off the interstate when we have a game. And then we could put our record under that. And then all those Valdosta Wildcats would drive by and see what our record is every day on their way to school. And we can put up a really nice sign. And I think that there's some discretionary. You're not talking about real estate anymore, are you? So the law says that you can talk about personnel, but it's about a person. not about people, not about employees, about an employee. Now, there might be exceptions to that. You might, to go low instead of high, you may have two people in a county office that have a knock-down drag out. You might not have personnel, about two folks, right? Or you could have a bunch of people and have a dining group, and you might need to talk about a bunch of personnel. But it needs to be about a person. But do you know that you can't receive evidence in executive session? So let's say, for instance, that I don't want to pick on teachers. I can't pick on teachers all the time. So let's say that we had let's say we had a county clerk, right? We're going to spread the equal opportunity offenders. Well, let's say we had a county clerk that we've been hearing some rumblings about. Somebody thinks that she might have her hand in the teeth. That was too gender specific. Somebody thinks he might have his hand in the teeth. Right? So let's have an executive session and talk about whether or not we think he's stealing from us. Ken, you worked next to him every day. Did you see anything happen? We're not going to tell anybody. We're back here in this closed door. We're not going to tell anybody. We're not telling anybody you're back here. You can't do that. You know why? Because we have a core belief in this country that a person has a right to stand in front of their accusers. And the General Assembly was very wise. And they said you cannot receive evidence against an employee behind closed doors. You're not going to hear argument. You're not going to impose disciplinary action. And you're not going to dismiss a public officer or employee without a public vote. So you can go back and you can talk about personnel, but any action that you take and any evidence that you receive has got to be done openly and, what's our word, transparent. You've got to do it out in the sunshine. And anytime you're talking about staffing, anytime you're talking about policy, anytime you're talking about employee benefits, all of that is policy, not personnel. We have got to get, especially our school boards, understanding the difference between policy and personnel. So here's what the law really says about real estate, that the real estate privilege is intended to protect the integrity of a transaction. So that means what you can talk about is the lease of property, the sale of property, or the purchase of property. The lease of a piece of property, the sale of a piece of property, or the purchase of a piece of property. It doesn't mean that you can get back there and say, okay, you know, we need to plan for growth for the next 500 years, so we should start acquiring land all around Cobb County. That's policy. That's not real estate. And those discussions cannot happen behind closed doors. Stefan Ritter, who was in Sam's office and now works for the Ethics Commission, opined that in order to trigger an executive session for litigation, there must be, at the very least, a letter of intent. So that we can't go back behind closed doors because we think somebody might sue us, or because we think that we might be facing litigation over some class action, when in fact, there's no reasonable trigger to be able to cause us to go here and talk about legal strategy. The purpose of executive session with an attorney is to discuss legal strategy. Now, why is that important? Several years ago, I knew a gentleman that was a city attorney for multiple cities in Metro Atlanta. His firm practiced local government law. And he was conducting a training session of elected officials where my friend Tommy Smith, that I told you about, was in attendance. And Tommy tells me that he advised these elected officials, look, you can go into executive session anytime you want to and talk about anything you want to as long as I'm in the room. It's not the person or the people that trigger executive session, it's the subject matter that triggers executive session. So merely the presence of an attorney does not invoke the litigation privilege. The person that's presiding is responsible for signing a notarized statement saying that they only discuss the things that are legally permissible. That is the most worthless piece of paper in the state of Georgia. All right, let me just ask y'all, honestly. Who in here is going to sign a piece of paper that says, I just broke the law for the last hour? Anybody going to do that? It's a worthless piece of paper. As a matter of fact, it's not really even a statement. They all have this one pre-typed up letter, and they all sign it, and I'm not even sure it's got a real signature on it, but, you know, that's up to your local commission to decide. Okay, so there are certain things that are not covered under the Act, and chief among them is the Georgia General Assembly. You know what I hear more from county commissioners and city council members than anything else about open meetings records? Open meetings legislation, open records legislation. I hear more than anything else. How dare the General Assembly in Atlanta put laws on us that they won't abide on themselves? Makes no sense. Now, to their credit, our General Assembly keeps most of its deliberations open. You can go, Jill Nolan's back there, you can go to just about any committee meeting you want to, can't you, Jill?
Get in the room.
if there's enough room in the room.
Right.
So, Jill's a great State House reporter for CNHI, y'all, if you have a better meter. So, fortunately, our General Assembly tends to be, as a matter of practice, open. But they put the law on county commissions and city councils and boards of education and do not bind themselves by that same law. Judicial proceedings have their own open common law and not subject to the Georgia Open Meetings Act as such. There are exemptions for law enforcement. There are exemptions for training sessions. We talk about some of these sort of incidental kind of occurrences that happen. There are some exemptions for like labor negotiations or mediations, service delivery mediations, and then hospital authorities have some special exemptions. And we're well acquainted with things down in South Georgia, believe me, you. Once again, I'm not going to say a word about lawyers writing this, but here's what the law says. Hospital authorities may meet in closed session to discuss commercially viable plans, proposals, strategies of competitive advantage. Whatever that means. They can do that. Peer reviews, and some of these are reasonable things, right? They ought to be able to have professional peer review in private. Note this, whether it's hospital authority or any elected body, there is a procedure for executive session. So some of you may be familiar with the case in South Georgia that was highlighted in Columbia Journalism Review last year, where a hospital authority was having their regular meetings at 9 o'clock. The first Wednesday of every month, they're having their regular meetings at 9 o'clock. Does that sound okay? They had public notice and they came and they had their regular meetings, right? But a reporter started noticing that they all came into the meeting together from the same door. And after about a year of doing that, he said, Jim, do you think it's funny that they all come in together from the same door? And so, come to find out, they've been meeting not at 9 o'clock, they've been meeting at 7 o'clock. And having a two-hour executive session before their 10-minute meeting. You reckon there were any violations of the Open Meetings Act? Well, Sam Olin said that there were. And they were fined. They were required to sign a memorandum of understanding stipulating to their violations of the act. They agreed to pay for any subsequent violations without court action. That's pretty severe. And then they had to subject themselves to open government training by Jim Zachary, which was the worst of all their penalties.
Can I make a comment?
Yes.
A lot of times with boards and commissions and authorities, they've never even seen a copy of any of these booklets, and they have not a clue that they're even subject to these things. And
right.
I think that's one thing I'd love to see this organization start doing, getting that in their hands, because a lot of times when you bring up the open meetings law, they look at you with this blank expression on their face. They don't have a copy of it.
Here's an offer to everybody in the room. The Georgia First Amendment Foundation will find a way to get anywhere and train anybody that'll listen. Is that fair?
That's fair.
Man. And all materials that we're giving you are available on our website. We're going to show you how to access it. We're going to run out of books tonight, but we want you to take all the books that we have, and you can get more from us. Ken's got them all in the back seat of his car. Am I right about that?
You are, man.
Look, government belongs to the government. And as we said in the beginning, if government is ever going to be out by and for the people, it's got to be out in front of the people. We cannot do the public's business behind closed doors. So Ken's going to now let me say whatever voice I've got left. But before we do that, not with respect to records, but with respect to meetings, what questions have we got?
I have a question about when we talked about the press, the constitution right of the press. I'm not sure where it falls, but I'm just curious as to if the press is protected by the Constitution, how is it that just following the media, how they get put out of or being silenced, whether recording, whether voice, audio, or video, how is that even allowed?
First of all, There is a distinction between silencing the press and the press having access, right? So that we all of us, regardless of what we do for a living, whether or not we work for a newspaper, radio station, or if we're an electrician or a physician, all of us have access to government. And we should all always have access. There are a few little bitty ticky things in Georgia law where the press has special access. For instance, guess what, guys? Members of the press here, you have special access to vehicle accident reports. You get a special privilege to vehicle accident reports. Congratulations. That's your prize. So there are very few areas where the press has special access. Georgia has a shield law for journalists. I wouldn't call it, we may get some more expertise here, I wouldn't call it a great shield law, but basically what it says is that you can't be compelled as a journalist to give evidence that you might have in a case if it can be gained from other reasonable sources. Is that a fair statement? So far as Sean Spicer not letting people in the room, you know, there's a gazillion reasons, I guess, why he can say that there's not enough room, or, you know, I wouldn't say at this point, and I'd be happy for any of the lawyers in the room to talk about this, that laws haven't been violated, but it's just not good precedent. Mm-hmm. Anybody got an opinion on that one?
Yeah. As an elected official, having worked for them for long enough, there is a point where journalists have to learn to be professional as well.
The other side of this coin, access for all of us is appropriate. But the other side of the coin is you should take that responsibility of access and reporting professionally and treat it as such. Right. Showing up at someone's door at midnight isn't professional.
And I will tell you that, and I don't think Jim will, I know that I won't, we're ever going to be in a position of defending the actions of all members of the media, professional or otherwise. Are there journalists that violate their own code of ethics? Absolutely are.
But my point is that you can just because you're an elected official or you hold a public office doesn't mean you are now subject to the abuse of the public because they think they deserve more access or different access.
No argument for me.
That's my point. Well,
I think that if you're talking about the public holding the press accountable, I think they do it every day with their pocketbooks.
I think she's asking if they can't get access, how can they tell citizens? And so
sorry to jump in.
That's
what I would say is that the government has the ability to make, not regulations, but make arrangements about press conferences and press briefings and things like that. And because it is limited, because there is limited space, they sort of do make rules. I think that the Washington Press Corps, for instance, could do a better job of protesting it and a more professional way of protesting it. But, you know, they do get to say whether cameras are on at this briefing or whether cameras are off, because if they didn't, if you didn't allow that, then the press could follow everyone around everywhere in the White House all day with a camera on, and they do get to regulate that.
And that's not new, is it?
No. I mean, it is very new for the situation that's going on now, where they're saying that open press briefings are not to be filmed. That's unusual, but.
Okay, we're gonna make sure that we give plenty of time to talk about records. And I think probably that if this crowd is like most of the ones that we talked to, you've got just as many questions, if not more, about accessing documents and public records. So I'm gonna let Ken take the baton now.
Great, thank you everyone. So before I get into the nitty gritty of public records laws in Georgia, I wanna just to make a couple of broad remarks about how the laws work and a little bit of context. So first thing is that everything that Jim talked about with respect to meetings, the principles involved there also apply to records. Why are records public? Because they belong to you, because government officials are doing your business. So what they put in documents, what they keep in their cabinet files, belongs equally to you as it does to them. So that's number one. The second thing is that there are some, a bit of context about open records in Georgia. So these laws have been in effect now over 30 years. During that time period, there are a couple of major changes or developments in society that have impacted those laws. First thing is that 30 years ago, most records were on paper and kept in filing cabinets. Today, most records are electronic. Now, that's really a good thing, because electronic records, in theory, should be a lot easier to get and more economical to get than boxes of paper records. That would be a good thing. On the other side, though, the other thing that's happened in the last 30 years is that we had this thing called the internet, and we had suddenly the ability to share information very, very broadly in society. And that included personal information about you that might be contained in these records. So suddenly, as the internet came along, there was this tension about what was in records and protecting people's privacy. So in the rewrite of the open records law and meetings law that happened a couple of years ago, one of the things that happened is that there were a lot more exemptions for personal data and personal information that is now protected under the law. And that has served in many ways to complicate your ability to get records, because now records can be reviewed by the people that have them to see if there's any personal information that ought to be taken out. Well, who does that? Well, they might argue that lawyers do. Lawyers cost a lot of money, so that drives up the price. Now, they shouldn't necessarily use lawyers. I'm going to talk about that a little bit later. But that is the tension that developed with respect to open records laws over the last 30 years. The final point I'll make before we get into the laws themselves and how they work is that compliance with the law varies widely across Georgia and across Atlanta. And it is, unfortunately, it depends on where you live. And that's unfortunate, because it's the same law everywhere. But how officials and how agencies choose to comply with that law varies greatly. And I'll give you one example. Last year, the Georgia News Lab, which is a class of investigative journalists, aspiring investigative journalists that I work with at Georgia State. David Armstrong, the head of that program, is here in the room today, did a little test, and they made open records requests of about 150 local government governments and agencies, just in the metropolitan area, not throughout Georgia. And they asked for two pieces of information, depending on which agency they were applying asking for. One of them, from law enforcement agencies, was their use of force policy. So this is not any secret. This is something they keep in a manual, right? And the reason for sending these requests is they wanted to see how long would it take for that agency to respond to that request. All right, in the case of that use of force policy, there were some law enforcement agencies that never responded. There were some that took 45 days, 60 days, some a little bit less, 2 weeks, a couple of days. Cherokee County Sheriff's Office supplied that record in 16 minutes. On a Friday afternoon.
Wow.
Right? 16 minutes after that request had come in, they had provided that record to the requester. So that's the kind of, unfortunately, that's the kind of you know, variance that you can see when it comes to records. And I hope what I can do in the next few minutes here is help you understand what the law is and also give you some strategies on how you can work with your agency if you're running into problems getting what you want. All right, so first of all, who's covered? All government bodies, authorities, and departments. Nonprofits, we talked about this, is to get one-third of their budget. Private entities, these would be contractors who get big government contracts to do work. Many of their records, not all, but many of their records would be covered under the Open Records Act. All right. So, I mean, this list is woefully inadequate, but basically anything that's on paper, anything that's on, you know, that's kept in a database, with some exceptions, is considered a public record under the law. In fact, the law says that all records are presumed to be public. And just like with meetings, they have to tell you why a meeting should be closed. It's the same thing with records. They have to tell you why you shouldn't get and what the legal exceptions are.
What about metadata associated with, say, a legal file?
Metadata is also covered, yes.
Okay, so if a county attorney says we don't have to turn over metadata based on an open records request, we're following through on?
I believe if it's part of the file, it's covered.
Okay,
yes.
Thanks.
Okay, so, all right, so here, let's get to the exceptions. So I'm gonna spend most of my time talking about government records, county commission, city council, that kind, not so much law enforcement. I will talk a little bit about law enforcement, but law enforcement is very much a separate process in Georgia. There are more exemptions, more exclusions related to police records. The main one is that any record that's associated with an open police investigation is closed, and you're not going to get that. When the investigation is complete, it's done, then all of those records are public, and you can get them, including if there were any video in the file, any audio in the file, but not until they are closed. One exception there is that an incident report, which is the initial police account of something that's happened, whether it's an accident or it's a crime or anything that's, when someone has called the police department and generates a report, that initial incident report, regardless of an open investigation, is considered a public record and is always open to you. So exceptions, again, here we have this personal information, birth dates, social security numbers, phone numbers. These are now subject to redaction under the law. Economic development records, there's an exclusion for them while negotiations are pending. So
State.
So if the state of Georgia is negotiating with a car manufacturer to come here, you know, you can't find out what kind of incentives and sweetheart deal might be offered until after the fact. Okay, sports recruiting. So this was a new exemption that came into the law last year, thanks to Kirby Smart at the University of Georgia.
I'm so smart.
Who felt that the open records laws, as they pertain to athletic departments, could be used to interfere with his ability to recruit players to the University of Georgia. So you used to be able to get records from athletic departments just like any other agency, and they were subject to the same laws. Now they have a 90-day grace period to answer those requests.
Is it specific to recruiting, or is
no? It's okay. Specific to athletic departments.
Okay.
Yeah. That's why it was. I mean, yeah.
Yeah. Recruiting is just how it began.
Exactly. When the University System of Georgia is recruiting candidates for major positions, chancellor, university presidents, those records are closed for a period of time until they come down to three finalists, and then the list of finalists and records associated with them are open. Grand jury records are closed and almost always closed unless they become public through a lawsuit or some other process. Real estate records, real estate appraisals prior to purchase would also be exempt. All right, all right, so here's the way the process is supposed to work. So as I said, all records are presumed to be open to inspection and copy. Requests, you can make your request of the agency either in writing or orally. I strongly suggest that you do it in writing so that you can have a record of, or you start to build a record of the process. The requests go to the records custodian in the jurisdiction that you're applying to. And as Jim said, there is supposed to be a records custodian for every city, county government, police agency. And that is also supposed to be readily discernible and available to you. So if you go to the website, you should not have to look too hard to find the name, telephone number, and email address of that person. Now, they may not list the person, it just may say, you know, the records custodian, email here at this, that email address. The responses to your request are due within 3 business days. Mm-hmm. Now, a distinction here, that doesn't mean that you're going to get the records in 3 days. That means that they have to answer you and say, okay, we got your requests, we're looking for them now, we have them readily available, you can come look at them day after tomorrow. Or, yes, we have them. They're in our storage facility. It's going to take us 5 days to go get them, and so they won't be ready until a week from now. That would be considered a valid response. But the law says that records are to be made available, quote, without delay. So there is supposed to be some urgency on the part of the agency to get you these records as quickly as they can. Law also says that the records have to be produced in the most economical way possible. So that's really important, because if they have these records electronically, and they could just, you could bring in your thumb drive and they could copy them on a thumb drive or give you a thumb drive, that's a lot cheaper than paying copying costs to get them all on paper. So if they have them electronically and you want them electronically, they should give them to you that way. Okay, so the next one, production charges are charged at the lowest rate of qualified person. So this is where you get into the area of redaction, and they look at these records and they say, well, this is a pretty large request. We need to take some time to go through them, and it's going to cost you this much in order for us to do that. Now, what the law says is they can't use their attorney who's making $150 an hour to do that. They have to use the person who is the lowest, or the cheapest qualified person, and particularly if it's just going through to look for social security numbers or telephone numbers, you know, that does not require a law degree to do that. And then if you do want copies, the copying charge is 10 cents per page.
They charge you an hourly rate for the copies as well?
I'm sorry, no.
No?
No. And then if it's expected to be more than $500, the agency can ask for that money up front so that they're sure that they can get paid. All right, so that's how things are supposed to work. Yeah, sorry, question.
Where it says response is due within this 3 business days?
Yeah.
So how long do they have to actually respond? I mean, not to respond, but once they respond within 3 days, what time period do they have to, if it's available to you, then to be able to give it to you?
So you mean so that they've responded within 3 days and they've said, we have the records, and, well, it's basically a negotiation then in terms of when they say they can get you the records. And again, what the law says is they have to do it, you know, as quickly as possible. But once they've met the initial 3 day.
But the law also says if they're routinely available, they should give them to you in the 3 days.
That's right, if they're routinely. So like, you know, things like minutes or agendas or things that are, yes, that they have available information, they should give it to you as soon as possible.
Are they required to qualify whatever fee they're charging?
I'm sorry, what?
Like, say they're charging these, you know, $800.
Yes.
These records. Are they required to qualify how they're coming out of this $800?
They are, and that's, I'm going to get into that right now, because, unfortunately, I don't have this slide in this presentation, but these are some of the things that you're likely to hear when records are denied you. Okay, so the first thing is the records are exempt. Okay, that could be. But if that's the case, they, in their response to you, need to cite that exemption. And you need to make sure that they do that. So make them find the specific place in the law that says, these laws are exempt for this reason. All right, another thing that you might hear is, we don't have records responsive to your request. We don't have records that are responsive to your request. So the question there is, you mean you don't have the records at all, or you don't have them in the way that I asked for them? And that's a very important distinction. And it comes into play a lot when you're asking perhaps for electronic data records. And you say, I would like to see the salary information for everybody who works for the government, and when they started work, and you know, when they left, and what their benefit package was, and so forth. All right. They have that information, but maybe they don't have one of the fields that you asked for. They say, well, I'm sorry, we don't have records that are responsive. So the answer there is, you ask them, well, how do you keep them? Give me those records. Next one. They respond and they say, we can provide these records to you, but it's going to cost you $5,000. And that's a lot. I mean, we've seen responses where it's actually been a much higher figure. But yeah, right. In the case of the Fulton County Tax Commissioner, it was $16 million.
Must be some good information.
So, but that's often a threat too. That's
right.
The way they keep
that's
well,
right.
We had a woman who made a school board request in Fayette, and they charged her $2,500 for the information, which was just absurd. But their attorney stuck to it, and eventually, you know, she did have the money to file a legal challenge, and she never got the record.
I'll tell you, those are cases that you should immediately seek mediation for through the AG's office.
Right. So the first thing, though, that when you get something like that, when you get this, what you consider to be too high a cost for what you're asking for, is ask them to break it down. All right, explain to me, you say $5,000. Give me the hourly rates here and who's going to be paid and how much, you know, this is going to. And when you get into that nitty gritty, that may be where you find out, well, we're going to pay our attorney $150 to review the records for redaction. Oh, really? Do we really need the attorney to pay to do that? Or is there somebody, you know, less expensive that can do that? So, you know, the first strategy is to understand, first of all, where that figure came out from, and then see if you can pick it apart and get it down. You know, does this cost assume that they're making copies for you and that you're getting them that way? Well, you may not want the copies. Maybe just coming in and seeing them and inspecting them is enough, right? So you can knock off those charges. The next thing you could do is, if it's still too much, figure out a way, if there's a way to narrow your request a little bit. Maybe you don't need quite as much as you thought you did, and start out smaller.
Do they have to give you an estimate? Amanda, the sample of the nurse request in here, you know, it says, like, you know, please give me an estimate of cost first.
Yeah.
But we've had some issues where the city clerk will go, we've already pulled the record, it's going to be $200, and you have to go back and go, no, I said, you know, call me before.
No, that's right. That's exactly right. They are supposed to be doing that estimate.
But kind of by law or whatever, there is something.
So, but you can put in your request that I won't pay anything in excess of a certain
correct
amount that
that's
they
right
would have to notify.
That's right. That's right. All right, so now we go to the next. This is so again, document your all, not your initial request, any kind of follow-up contact that you have. I mean, it could be as simple as just maybe create a spreadsheet, say, this is the date that I sent it, I got my response on this date, or I didn't get a response, so I called them and I spoke to somebody, then they responded here, and all of that becomes important if you you know, if you have to challenge your the person to gain access, and you're building that case. Be as specific as you can with your request. This is particularly true with email, because there's so much email. If you want emails, say I want to see emails that relate to the, you know, the such and such contract. And this between this time.
How far back can you go?
Well, that depends on the record retention schedule of the particular document. So Georgia law lays out how long they're supposed to keep certain things, and it varies depending on the kind of document. Generally, it's 5 years is they're supposed to keep it before they get it.
Because I made a request. My regular request from a status quo organization to find out about some funding that they received in collaboration with some other organizations that they umbrellaed.
Mm-hmm.
And they said to me that I knew, I don't know what happened to those records, and I don't have access to them because I don't know where they are, they don't exist. I knew the organization has restructured, those people are no longer here anymore, even the office manager. So what do you do then?
Well, I think you keep working to find somebody who, within that organization, who was there and who doesn't. Because that's not a good answer. I don't know, I'm new. That, you know, that is really, that's
the institution of such.
Yeah, right.
And then she said to me, well, you should get a lawyer to pursue it, because
Try the AG's office.
Yeah.
And I can't afford a lawyer.
So that, yeah, that's the next tip. So you, you know.
It's the only attorney who can get that information.
Right. So if you still are not getting anywhere with the agency or the entity, you do have recourse with the attorney general in the same way that if you feel like a meeting has been closed improperly, you can go to Jennifer.
So there's a statute of limitation? How far? You said 5 years or 10 years?
Well, it depends on how long they're required by law to keep that.
Yeah, and that's going to be deeply codified. We could get the answer for you if you want to tell us the specific record. One of us will research it and find out that for you. But I know that there are some people who will say, and that some of you might say this, hey, well, the AG's office, they're not interested in me. They're not going to listen to me. They won't take my complaint. I'm telling you, it works. But you've got to do your homework. You've got to know what you're asking for. You've got to have made a reasonable request. You've got to be able to show that paper trail. And you present it to the AG's office as a package. And my personal experience is that their office will follow up for you.
Right.
Don't always feel like you've got to go hire an attorney. Now, that is a recourse, but it's not the only recourse.
And I left one thing off before you get to the AG's office, but is if you're not getting satisfaction with the records custodian, go hire. You know, go to his or her boss.
Right.
Go to an elected leader, on whatever body it is, and say, I have been trying to get this, they're not returning my phone calls, and see if you can't get some help there.
It's also worth noting that if they come back to you and say that we're not required to keep those records or to hold our record retention schedule plus report, that doesn't mean they don't have them. And if they have them, they still have to.
That's right.
Right. So you have to correspond it. And you can also ask for the destruction records just to make if you're feeling like you're not getting a straight answer. Yeah. You can ask for the records.
Yeah. Tell me, when did you get rid of them?
Yeah. When did
you? You know, I would say as just a regular citizen, great experience at the Attorney General's office. We had a school board tell us it was going to be 14 years and $300,000. It's amazing when the Attorney General's office calls the school board how fast they change their mind.
But I'll also tell you, if I'm not mistaken and they didn't change it, the law says if you do go to court and it is found that the person who's the records keeper of the agency was in violation, they are responsible right off the bat. You don't even have to ask for legal fees. All fees incurred, if I remember, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe it says that if you take them to court and they lose because they didn't follow the law, they are responsible for all of your legal fees, including attorneys.
Even if they no longer work there anymore.
It's the agency that would be in
charge. It's not the agency.
Not the
agency. Well, the agency
is
still there. I'm saying the person that was
a non-compliant. I will tell you all not to focus on the law for open records and open meetings being punitive. The point is for it to be corrected. And the battle should always be not about you winning,
right,
but should be about public access to public records.
Amen.
Don't worry about penalizing or hurting somebody or embarrassing somebody. That's superficial.
So you can go to the AG and make a complaint with the AG, and that can be a very effective way to resolve an issue. If you still can't get satisfaction, you can sue the entity, but that would require a lawyer, more expense, and would be going through the court process to try to hold them accountable. Yes?
Are there rules that govern how government agencies retain their records, and what do you do if you find out that government agency hasn't been following their own records? Some counties say 7 years, some say 5. But if you contact them and they tell you that, well, we don't have those records because I'm new here, what do you do? Is there some violation? Can you go to the Attorney General and say, hey, these people aren't keeping records at all?
Yes, that would be a great cause of action. We have the First Amendment Foundation has a list of attorneys who specialize in this area. It's on our website. You can consult that. Any of them are terrific advocates for this. And the last thing I've got here to show you is, this is just, this is in the red handbook, but this is a sample open records law, I mean, an open record request letter. So it cites the law. You fill in the blanks of what you're asking for. One thing I would highlight, which probably can even be strengthened a little bit, which is very effective, is at the very end, the law requires response within 3 business days. You receive this letter and provide sanctions for non-compliance. If you want to amp it up a little bit, you can say, civil penalties under this law are $1,000, or for then $2,500 for the next one. But I've been told that when people understand that there are consequences for not complying, that that increases the chance that they won't comply.
I would like to note, there is a very short window of time to file a suit if there is a violation of the Open Meetings
Act. She knows firsthand, y'all.
I have filed 2 suits against a governmental agency, and I lost one because I filed it too late. You have 90 days to file from the date that you knew about the violation, but not longer than 6 months from the date of the violation. And that's very key, because I lost because I filed it outside of the 90 days, but within the 6 months. And they said, you had constructive notice of this violation. You didn't file it on time, case dismissed. We never got to the merits. So be aware of that very short window of time to file suit if you proceed to court.
Excellent. Okay, let's give you a few quick hit things, and we'll try to field a few more questions as we start to wrap up. Some of the best advice I can give you is something that Brenda Lee's grandmother used to always say, and that is, you catch more flies with honey than vinegar. And I don't know why anybody wants to catch flies, but be nice.
Yes.
Be polite to folks. Be reasonable. You don't need to go in pounding on the desk and demanding and saying the word pursuant. I will tell you that I tell all of the journalists in my newsroom, never use the word pursuant when you're talking to somebody. You know, just, and let me tell you, I agree 100% with what Ken's saying. Sometimes you need a paper trail. But sometimes a records request is just this simple. Cole, I forgot to pick up the minutes last night. Can you run back there and get me a copy of it? It's magic. It works. Saying somebody's name, being polite, saying please, saying thank you. And you know what all records custodians have in common, and all elected officials have in common? They're human beings. And you treat them bad, and they're going to bristle. When they can make it available to you like that, they're going to take that 3 days. Just because you were not a nice person. Be nice, be reasonable, and make your request in a way that is reasonable. I'm going to tell you another magic trick. So, y'all know what the 2 most common responses are to an open records request in the state of Georgia? I know this is deep research on my part. The 2 most common responses to an open records. Number 1, the most common response to an open records request in the state of Georgia is, here you go. That's the most common response, is you get your record. 2nd most common response, we have no records responsive to your request. 9 times out of 10, what that means is, you didn't ask us just right. So I've got a magic trick. I guarantee it works. Doesn't always work, but it works most of the time. We have a records custodian down in South Georgia named Paige Dukes. Isn't that a great name for a Southern records custodian? And Paige readily admits that we all play the game. And so Paige and I have had this conversation a gazillion times. I can have a reporter go to Paige and ask for something that they don't have. And she will say, we have no records responsive to your request. The reporter comes back and tells me. I pick up the phone and I say, hey, Paige, how in the world would Jason have to ask you for that record to get what he wants? And she laughs and says, Just tell him to ask for Schedule D. It works. You know why? Because we're people. And people want to help people. Records custodians are not bad people. Sometimes they're in bad moods. Sometimes you put them in a bad mood. Mostly because you started your sentence with the word pursuing. Just be nice. Be a human being. Do the same thing with your elected officials. Right? You know what elected officials were before they were elected? You. They're people that ran for office hoping perhaps to make a difference. Sometimes they get to be a part of this good old boy network. Sometimes they get droned in. Because you know the first thing that happens to everybody when they get elected to office? Sometimes they get trained. This is how we do things around here. Right? Am I wrong? Right? They start training them. They start telling you how we do things. Some of that's nefarious and some of it's not. Some of it's just good old boying, but good old boying is not good enough. So, sometimes elected officials are surprised when you help them learn. When you say to them, did you know that you cannot be fined or penalized or put in jail for telling me what they did in the executive session? Listen, I have had members of boards of education tell me, Jim, I'd love to tell you what we talked about, but they throw me in jail and I got kids to feed. They can't. Our good friend David Hudson, if you don't know David Hudson, you need to. David is a giant among men. I think one of the great lawyers in the state, a great First Amendment advocate, and just a scholar to Joan. And David loves to say that there is no local statute, no code of ethics on the county commission, no state law that can circumvent one person's First Amendment rights. Unless it's proprietary information and they want to come out and tell you what they talked about in executive session, there is nothing that their fellow elected officials can do about it other than snub. And I think you could probably put up with some snubbing for the right cause, right? I have people come up to me all the time about, man, how do y'all find these stories in the paper? How do y'all get this stuff? We exposed a board of education. They went over to, government loves to hide in retreats. I can tell y'all are retreating from the public when you take these out-of-town retreats. And they went to an out-of-town retreat over near Brunswick, and they worked out a deal where one member of the board of education was going to get reelected. He was going to serve 1 year. He was going to step off. They were going to hire him to be over facilities in the school system for $70,000. And then they were going to wait until enough time had elapsed where they could handpick his replacement to serve out the term so that then he could be an incumbent and run for the office and they'd have enough votes to get their way. And they all talked about it, and we had it on the front page of the newspaper. You know how we found out about it? One of those members of the Board of Education started feeling dirty. Now, it took me 3 months to get him to use his name in print, because I wasn't going to run with it if he wouldn't own it. When he decided that he couldn't stand it and he was going to own it, he came clean. They were as mad as an old wet hen. But listen, we didn't surprise them. We went to every member of that Board of Education, and we asked them, did you talk about this in executive session? You know what happened when we asked them?
How'd you hear that?
Unexpected. They all told the truth. You know why? Because they're people. People like to tell the truth. They want to tell the truth. And when they know you've got the facts, more often than not, they're going to tell you the truth. Our lawyer friends will tell you, never ask a question if you don't know the answer. That's not always true. But I'm just telling you, talk to people first. It's not our job as journalists or as citizens to embarrass government. We need to work with government, and we can. Ken, do you have anything to share on that?
I have a question right here.
What does it mean when you're talking
talking to a Board of Education member, and they continuously say throughout the conversation, off the record, off the record, off the record.
Well, I'm going to let Ken talk about this. He's a great journalist, but I will tell you, you're only off the record with me when I say you're off
the record. Well, that's right, yeah. So off the record is a negotiation. It's not an official saying, this is off the record, and now you accept it. As I, as the reporter, if I say, no, I'm sorry, I don't want your information unless you're going to give it to me on the record so that it can be published with your name attached to it. And they may not want to do that, and that's fine. But, I would have to be convinced that the person's life was in danger if their name was attached to what they were going to tell me for me to consider.
It's a school board, right?
What is a citizen's responsibility to an elected official when they say those words? Can we just let them keep talking?
Well, but first of all, unless you're recording it, there is no record, right?
Right.
It's just words in the air.
It doesn't
but,
mean we can't.
But I'll tell you, my friends, because I'm a newspaper man, my friends start every conversation with this. It's off the record. Doesn't mean he'll beans, because I tell on them every time. Let me tell you some things that local officials would do well to learn. These are just some really quick bullet points. Exemptions must always be interpreted narrowly. That's real important. So that their lawyers can't take the broad interpretation of the meetings exemption or the records exemption. You have to take the most narrow interpretation. Number two, the Act protects disclosure in good faith. If a records custodian accidentally gives you something that should have been redacted, but they did it in good faith, the Act protects the good faith disclosure. They can't be prosecuted for that. The Act does not require the charging of fees. If they want to give it to you, let them. Initial incident reports are always public. That includes, sometimes they try to hide this thing that they call the supplement. That includes the supplemental narrative that they want to hide on the back sheet. The word is still kind of out on initial, we always get questions about this, about body cams and vehicle cams. We know in closed cases those are all public records. We hope the courts are going to say that those are initial incident reports. That's what I think should happen. We'll see where that thing goes. Internal affairs reports after the investigation is completed. The problem with it is they never close those daggum investigations and they have different reports. Performance evaluations can be redacted, but they are public record. Applications can be redacted, but they are public record. So those are some things that I think that elected officials probably need to know and records custodians. Know this, secrecy always breeds suspicion. Openness always incubates confidence. The more open you are, the less suspicion. Even if you're not up to no good, folks think you are. So the more open you are, the less no good they think that you're up to. There are three things that I like to always talk about. Number one is that I want elected officials to understand, and you should know this about your elected officials, that there is no requirement to go into executive session. That's right. There is no requirement. So they can go into executive session to talk about personnel, but they don't have to. They can go into executive session to talk about real estate, but they don't have to. They can go into executive session to talk about pending or real litigation, but they don't have to. It's an allowance, it's not a requirement. Every time they go behind closed doors, they choose to do it. Sometimes they should, right? Who wants to embarrass somebody with personal, private information that you need to talk about, right? Nobody wants somebody to be, let's say they did something untoward. You really want that information out there, and I'm not talking about maybe illegal activity, but just something that you wouldn't want their kids to know about, right? Sometimes it's okay to go behind closed doors, and it's reasonable to do so, but it's still a choice. Yeah.
Hey, quick question. We have a city government, a county government, and with regards to the personnel exception for executive sessions, right? So. These committee appointments come up, whether it's the County Development Authority Board, or maybe it's the Finance Committee or something like that. The city interviews the candidates for those positions in public in an open meeting. The county always goes to executive session. You see it on the agenda the next day for, you know, under consent agenda, approved Bob Smith for Development Authority.
Right. Mm.
What's the law say?
Okay, so that when government is hiring the executive head of an agency, and I don't know that the state's ever codified what that means, right? But when they're hiring the executive head of an agency, that 14 days up until the time they make a final decision, they have to disclose all records relevant to the top three candidates. There's a little bit of problem, again, with the way the law is written, right? So first of all, the media thinks what that means is they have to release the names of three candidates. It's not a naming law, it's a records law. So what you're requested then isn't the names of the top three. You have to file a records request for all documents pertaining to the top three candidates for position whatever, school board superintendent. And then they have to release resumes, applications. Of course, that will contain those names. The problem with the language of the law is it says up to three. So I'm going to tell you what happens in Georgia. You go in, you make the request, and they say, "Oh, we just have one. All the rest of them disappeared. They're all gone." Now, I'm going to tell you this because I know it happens, and I found it happening. The city manager or the county manager calls each candidate and says, "Hey, you were one of the top three, but we're not going to hire you. Do you want to withdraw your application?" Anybody think that doesn't happen? That's exactly the way they'll do it. So you usually end up, you get one. Most local governments are conducting interviews with those top three when they do narrow it to three in the area.
But can I, if you're looking at development, to use your development authority scenario, if you're appointing development authority board members, that those interviews have to be done in public.
Yes.
So
that's a whole the finance, the county finance committee, right? If they're gonna, if they decided they wanted to appoint, you know, Bob Smith to the county finance committee, I mean, don't they have to discuss that in public?
Yeah, that's absolutely. Yes. Public. Yeah, that's public policy. Yes. Yeah.
So that they're violating, if they go into executive session to do that, and they just come out and say, "We just named."
Right. Let me tell you something else they can't do. They can't come out of executive. Here's if I want to know whose school board does this. They go into executive session, right, every month, and they come out, and board member A says, "I make a motion to accept the superintendent's recommendation made in executive session." Board member D says, "I second that motion." All in favor say, "Aye." And the choir sings. Anybody see that? Anybody watch that happen? Happens every single month. Guess what? The Attorney General office has said that's illegal. They can't do it anymore. Here's what they've got to do. A motion for a vote has got to be clear enough that anybody in the audience knows what a yes vote means and what a no vote means. So, would you know what they were voting for or against if they were voting on superintendent's recommendations? They've got to. Now, here's what we've got them doing in South Georgia now. They have them all printed up, ready to go. And they just hand them to us. They throw them up on the screen and they say, "These are all the people that we're hiring. These are all the people that we're firing. These are all the people that have tenure, but we had to hold their feet to the fire to get them to do it." There's no prohibition against revealing what goes on behind closed doors. They tell you if they want to, they're not required to go behind closed doors, and there's no protection just because the lawyer is present. They can't say, "Hey, we've got the lawyer in the room, let's throw a party." Right? It's not the personnel in the room that trigger the executive session, it's what's being discussed. Okay, just a few quick questions, and I'll let Ken make some closing remarks.
How do these laws pertain to Georgia elected officials on a federal level? So
They don't. Right. So the federal officials, like federal agencies are subject to the Freedom of Information Act, otherwise known as FOIA. I don't know if there's any equivalent on meetings.
Yeah, it's a federal meeting law,
but it only applies to policy making boards.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Also, the FOIA law does not include
Congress, so it's the same.
I think it's good sometimes just to randomly ask certain departments or agencies for particular documents, just to see how they do respond to you. I think it's a good exercise for everybody in every county to at least try that, because you'd be, probably be surprised how different the agencies or departments are in their response.
What I do discourage you from are just needling the haystack type requests. There's no sense to infuriate local officials. If you're asking for something that you can use, ask for something reasonable. Don't just do these needling the haystack requests, or you may get a data dump like Bear Reed.
I want to just add one thing. We're looking for, and I can't say we'll take your case, no guarantees, but we're looking for a case of a private citizen asking for important information, something that is substantial and of value and important to the public, who does not get any response in 3 days. And we'd like to see if that agency is doing that repeatedly and has a pattern of that. So if that happens to y'all, let us know. Usually the
Sean's cell number is
No, but there's a form on our website you can put in on that.
Yes.
Is David Hudson Hall Barrett? Is that who?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
it's funny. Mark Thomason gave me his name and your name all in the same conversation. And I knew
he's a heck of a lot smarter than I am.
That would be hard.
Other questions before we...
I would echo Ken's comments, though, and all the other comments about making allies out of your elected officials.
Yeah.
And I started off as a First Amendment advocate. I found out it's easier to get elected than do it from the inside. And I literally write letters to organizations on county stationery saying, here are the records you need to ask for. And it really pisses them off when I send them letters out with the document titles on them. But it's so much easier. And one of the things that you need to look out for, too, is what is actually a record that has to be retained. And we had a little issue where I had to start fighting back a little bit because they were trying to lessen what was in the minutes. And it was just they voted, they discussed terms, and left it at that. And the rationale was for doing this, well, we've got it on video, so they can always go back and see the video. It's not mandated that they retain the videos. And see, that's the problem. And you have to know what you can keep and what you can't keep, because all of a sudden the video disappears because there is no retention requirement for that video. So you have to be really careful and take a DVD over to them and say, I would like a copy of that meeting. If you want to hold them accountable for something they said in that meeting, go and get a DVD and make them copy of the meeting.
At least I think that's something. Did you have a comment?
I have a question. For settlements of litigation that are discussed in executive session, we approve those at our actual public meeting, but I'm curious to know how much information should be included or needs to be included during a public information session, particularly because sometimes there could be terms of the litigation that include terms of confidentiality. And some of them may have even involved personnel.
I know that the dollar amounts absolutely have to be.
Dollar amounts do.
Right, absolutely, because that's taxpayer. That's,
at the very least, you want those captions that let people know what was said. But I agree with you. If there are confidential agreements, then abide by those agreements, right? I mean, there are reasons why that confidentiality exists in the document. But the public has a right to know how their money's being spent. So if there's a financial settlement, the public has a right to know why they paid out those dollars.
So, we get workers' comp settlements. So is it just to say workers' comp settlement for X, or do you see that being too broad?
I think as a member, if I was a taxpayer in that jurisdiction, I'd want to know a little bit.
I mean, I would say at a minimum you would want to know what agency was involved. So is this the police department? Is this the public works department? I think the name of the individual who's being, paid by the taxpayers for the settlement, that should be public.
That's often the confidentiality, though.
Yeah, it might be, but I mean, from
I would want enough of the cap. You want to get an idea of how
the point of the confidentiality is to keep the government from having other bunch of other claims because they pay one so people see it. So they just a little balance.
Yes, I've read a few settlements, okay? I'm struck by your statement that the public should know why the settlement was made. As I ran through my head right away, I don't think I've ever, and I remember, I'm not at all saying I've read a bunch of them, but clear narrative as to why we settled.
Well, if I am paying my taxes.
I'm saying I'm liking what I'm hearing.
Right. I'm not being defensive. What I'm saying, what I'm explaining is that if I'm paying my taxes.
Yes.
And you as an elected official are settling lawsuits.
Yes.
With my money.
Yes.
I want to know why you got so many lawsuits and how you're settling. Are they in my favor? Are they in the favor of the other litigant? Because that money that you're settling that lawsuit is my money. And it is my interest that you're settling the lawsuit over. So I want to know, if nothing else, I want to know, daggummit, how many lawsuits has the city got against him anyway? And what are those lawsuits about?
And to be transparent, I've looked mostly at settlements by law enforcement.
So I want to know, are they beating folks up and then having to settle lawsuits? I want to know that.
See,
and I should.
That's what I see. I've not seen much.
That's like an NJC report to me.
But okay, I appreciate your observation.
So what should the citizens do in situations where you have all these settlements coming up, and it's obvious that things are going on in government that haven't been addressed, and you still have these officials that are sitting in these positions that are allowing these things to happen? What do you think?
Vote them out of office.
I knew the answer.
What do you think should be done about elected officials' use of private email, private phones?
Hey, guess what? Guess what the law says.
What?
If they're doing public business on private devices, it's public.
How do you know, though? How do you?
You gotta catch them.
Okay.
You gotta be real tricky. You gotta get up real early in the morning. But here's what happens a lot of times. They may be using their handheld device, but they're texting somebody on a government
device.
Right. So they're sending an email to a government email. And that's usually how you end up catching them. I'll tell you what, one time we busted a bunch of county commissioners because they were violating the Open Meetings Act by sitting around the table. There were 15 commissioners that were sitting around a table texting one another before the vote. One of them felt dirty and showed me his problem.
Well, if they're using private devices and you make a request properly and they don't, it's non-responsive, they don't send you that, isn't it?
Bluff them.
Yes.
Sometimes you just got to bluff them.
I mean, the main thing I would do is make sure they understand, and you can get the Attorney General's statement that a lot of people are like, well, it's my phone, you can't have my text. You need to make them understand you're violating the law if you say it's non-responsive when it is responsive.
All right, we're going to take a few more. We're going to have to wrap up because we're taking too much of y'all's time. Yes, ma'am.
So theoretically, in the middle of a public meeting, an official was actively fooling around with their phone in front of God and everybody. Could we maybe have a chance of making a case that that device was used in the commission of public business?
The thing about it is, if you have reason to believe that what they were doing was a violation of the Open Meetings Act, which says that all deliberations of the public business of a quorum must be conducted in public. Mm-hmm. I guess it's in public because they sit in a room, but the public has no access to that deliberation. And there have been a few times that the AGs have sent letters saying that electronic devices in public meetings do constitute a violation. So I think it is something you can pursue, but I wouldn't bark up an empty tree. All you coon hunters know what that means.
Yeah, and I could say in full disclosure, I've started taking my laptop to meetings because as opposed to just taking notes in my notebook, it's just easier for me to send myself an email to follow up or sometimes I've done research, like if somebody has been speaking and said something, I'm like, I'm trying to see, can I just see what they're talking about? And I brought that up in a meeting. So it may appear one way, and I'm not saying that there aren't times when discussions may occur regarding the topic, but it's not, I wouldn't just presume that that's what's going on if you see somebody with a device.
So that would be your personal laptop or the county's laptop?
This is the county's laptop.
Okay, well then that's fine.
Ken, some final parting words?
Well, I think my final parting word is, I would just say on behalf of our organization, Georgia First Amendment Foundation, we are here for you all. And we want to help you as much as we can. We want you to participate as much as you can with us, come to trainings, join us. We do important work on your behalf and the people of Georgia, and thank you all for being here. And,
all this information you find on our website, gfaf.org. All the books that are here are there for the taking, so the red books deal with local government in general, the blue books are law enforcement. Thank you so much for being here.
Are these slides on this?
I can make them away.